But thanks for staying. We're going to talk a little bit about a new acquisition we made and we closed on about a month ago. I'm so happy that's done. You don't even know. It was an acquisition of InRelease, which is a set of release management intellectual property. And we'll be incorporating that into our products over the next couple of months. Before we get started, I'm Ed Blankenship. I'm a product manager at Microsoft for Visual Studio, ALM, and Team Foundation Service, and including release management. I've got a couple ways you can contact me. Feel free, if you have any questions during the session, feel free to let me know. I'm happy to take those. Here's my email address. There's a Twitter handle, my blog. Additionally, I'm the lead author for a couple of Team Foundation Server books. Those are available out on Amazon or your favorite bookstore today. But let's get started. So InRelease, how many folks are familiar with InRelease? Yeah? How many folks are using InRelease? All right. So we have lots of new customer potential, which is why we acquired. So how many folks are familiar with Team Foundation Server? All right, great. I can skip a whole bunch. We can just do more demo today because I don't have to talk about Team Foundation Server. So when we think about the cycle for how we deliver software, you know, it starts out with thinking about the requirements that we need. Those go on a product backlog. Developers and testers go through different sprints and iterate over that. Ultimately, it gets delivered to production. But there's lots of different releases that end up going to production as well. So once you start to get past the hello world stage, you know, simple apps, we start to have lots of things that need to go to production in a somewhat structured format. So right now, what we see is those deployments are pretty complex. They're usually error prone as well. How many folks have automated their release process, their deployment process? Oh, that's good. How many folks are still using manual processes? Yeah. Oh, how many folks publish from Visual Studio? Oh, come on. It's okay. No problem. We're building more and more tools, so you don't have to do that. And for the most part, it's actually kind of chaotic too. So what we've done in the in-release product, in the release management pieces, we actually want to take the same builds and be able to reliably deploy them into all the different environments. So we'll coordinate all that for you. We'll manage that. We will do all sorts of stuff. We can provision environments as you need to. We will also keep investing into the product. So what you see today and what you'll see when I demo today is actually what we acquired. It's not, we haven't Microsoftized it. We haven't integrated it into Team Foundation Server yet. But it's just to give you a glimpse of the kind of things we're going to be able to do with it. There's testing time that's involved there. And you can think about your release process in a couple of different ways. You start out with coding in Visual Studio or your favorite application or your favorite IDE. Normally, you'll compile it and package it together. You might have a process. How many folks actually in the dev test side of things, they actually provision a new environment instead of using another environment, a static environment? Hey, that's good. So we want to be able to have cost savings around this. And we've had this a little bit in lab management today. But we'll be able to do this a little bit better now. Provisioning, deployment, there's usually a testing phase, whether that's exploratory testing, manual testing, or automated testing. And then ultimately, you get to the point where you're going to do a prod deploy. Now, what typically happens before you get to the production deployment is you will have deployed and tested lots and lots of different builds before you do the one single production build. And so we've learned from that. and that's kind of the pattern that ends up happening. So what we've done is we've actually put some automation around that so that you can track that. And so now you can break that release process down into different stages. So this may be familiar with a lot of folks who may end up having these kinds of stages when you do that. So you have the dev stage there, the integration stage, the QA, pre-prod. And ultimately, it's just a bunch of stages. So, and you figure out how that works within your organization. But if you'll notice, the build and package part is actually not in each stage. We expect that to have happened already, and we will use the same build package as we go through so that you can verify in each of your individual environments. So deployments happen. And then also, if you what we've also done inside of in release is you have lots of different options of how you can orchestrate that deployment. So we have the idea of being able to approve different stages. You can notify those approvers and get approvals from stakeholders. So that's, you know, I'll show you that. There's lots of different approvals that you can set up. You can do any kinds of tests. So for example, manual tests, automated tests, you can create test data. You can configure your application once you've deployed it. You can install it. And then ultimately, you can set up the infrastructure, whether that's a static environment or a new environment that you've set up. So we've got lots of tools already in the stack that help you do this. So for example, Lab Manager is one of them. How many folks know about Lab Manager? OK, good. Lab Manager is a it's a feature built into TFS, Team Foundation Server, that works with System Center to be able to set up dev and test environments. It kind of self-empowers individual developers and testers to spin up their own environments and tear them down when they don't need them. You can do network isolated environments. There's all sorts of different things that you can do with it. We've got MS Tools and TFS Deployer that basically handles installation. We've got Microsoft Test Manager that's able to handle the testing aspects for you. With configuring the environment, you can use tools like PowerShell. You can use custom tools to configure your application for however you need. And in release, ultimately, will help you automate that deployment. So it will deploy the same exact way to each of the environments. And how many folks have the same exact automated deployment for every environment, including production? Yeah? How many folks have a different deployment, you know, for pre-production and before, and then production is different? Yeah, that's typically what happens. And then how many people find deployment problems on production day? Because you haven't tested the deployment out. Yeah, it happens a lot. So the idea we have is that we want to enable you to be able to do that the same way and be able to test out the deployment from environment to environment and still be able to protect production in a way that we need to be able to do that. So I'll show you that in the demo today. So we automate the workflow, the people workflow, and allows full traceability. So not only do we handle the automation of the deployments, but we will also track the different release artifacts that you need. So the sign-offs, the approvals, the acceptance criteria, there's a lot of different things that you can go in and capture during that process. So if you're in a high regulatory kind of environment, you can have the necessary documentation you need for your auditors. So here's kind of how it works. I just want to show this before we get started. These are the pieces that are necessary. So Team Foundation Server is just regular old Team Foundation Server. And in-release builds on top of Team Foundation Server right now. So that has the build process, and the build process puts out a drop location. Usually that's in a file share of some sort. And then what happens is it notifies the in-release server. So the in-release server will work with a couple of pieces. So in-release web is a website that I'll show you that can handle approvals so people don't have to have anything installed on it. And then there's an in-release desktop client. And the desktop client has all of the pieces that you'll need as a developer or an operations person to kind of manage those releases. So those talk back to the in-release server. And then on each of the environment servers, you'll actually have what's called the deployment agent. And so this is how it works today. Like I mentioned, we just acquired this. We were working on getting it integrated into the whole product. But the nice thing about this acquisition was it already worked. It was already built on TFS. And so we don't have many changes that we needed to do to enable you to start using that. So there's a preview that's available today. Microsoft.com/visualstudio/inrelease is the current site. You can download that preview and start using it today. Eventually, over time, we will not have these separate pieces. The client will move into Visual Studio. The server will move into Team Foundation Server. What we will have is a deployer agent as well that will be very similar to, you know, System Center agents as well. So, all right. So, any questions so far before we get started? All right. Cool. Well, let's go take a look. I'm done with slides, by the way. All right. Let's move on over. Okay. All right, so there's a couple pieces here I wanted to show you. This first piece, let me go ahead and I'll zoom this up, make sure everyone can see. Everyone can see in the back? All right, cool. All right, so right now I've logged in as Julia. Julia is one of our release managers. And Julia is looking at the release explorer, which shows any approvals that are necessary for her. So you can come in here. Briefly, what I want to do is I actually want to show you some of the previously approved builds. So you can go back in time and look at all the individual builds that have been released already. So you'll see we've got one here. It's about a month ago. It's the Fabricam call center. Probably seen that one before. And if I take a look in here, it says it has one component. So this release is made up of one component. And inside of in-release, you can actually have multiple components. And so we realize that your application is not just one component. It's not in one build. You may have it in several different builds, and we want to be able to take that and manage those pieces together. So you'll see that we actually do allow you to do that. I'll show you how to configure that a little bit later. But for now, you can see that it takes advantage of the call center site component. And then we've taken the nightly build from July 9th, 2013. And it's the second one of the day. So that was what we have there. You can start to see a couple of other things. Brian Keller was the one who set this up. I can even click over here and get some information. So we know that this release is already in production. It was accepted manually by Brian Keller on that date. He validated after it got deployed, and it was installed at that time. So we've got all this information. We can even go back to previous stages. So here's the QA stage. Notice that in this stage, it was actually automated. It was an automated acceptance. And then we've got several different pieces, including comments that are left by the approvers that have done this. So you can look at each of them. Dev is the same way. So, and you can set these up however you'd like, and I'll show you how we go about doing that. All right. Now, before we get started, I'm going to open up the in-release client. I'll zoom that up here for those in the back. All right. Since this is a separate application right now, and it will be that way once we have the 2013 release, one of the nice things we're going to do is we're going to package in release as part of Team Foundation Server and Visual Studio. So if you buy certain versions of Visual Studio, you'll get the in release client with it, and Team Foundation Server will include the in release server as well. So that will be available to you. It won't be integrated like you would expect, but it'll at least be packaged. There's not something that you'll have to buy additionally. The way we will also do it is we will have a model for the deployers, the deployment agents. So you'll be very familiar with that model as well. All right, so the first thing you'll do is you go to administration, and you'll connect it up to a Team Foundation server. Interestingly enough, you can actually connect it up to multiple Team Foundation servers as well. So if you have multiple Team Foundation servers where components are coming from, you can actually set that up and have that go through here. All right, where is it? There we go. So it just tells us a little bit. It works with 2013, 2012, and 2010 TFS. And then what do you want it to connect as? And the one thing about that account is you just want to make sure that it has the permission that says make requests on behalf of other users. That's not normally turned on, so you'll have to make sure that it has that permission. But you don't want to give that permission to every account, just service accounts. Yes? That's a good question. I think it would work with the service, now that I think about it. Let me check with that afterwards. I haven't tried it. It's a good point. All right. Some other things you can do. There's some settings in here. You can see kind of what versions you have. If you have an SMTP server, this is where you'll do that so that people can get emails about approvals that are needed. Over time, you can do all sorts of things like have the deployers check for new deployments every couple minutes or so. In this case, it's 60 seconds. And then users here, I'm going to show you a couple of things. We can take users from TFS or AD if you want, or you can create your own users in here. You'll notice that Brian here is a release manager. And you can put, his email address. If we already know that in TFS, we'll go ahead and consume that as well. Yep.
Is this something that can be used to deploy to multiple clients, or is it really intended to be used within a single organization?
Ooh, great question. The way you could set that up is you could have the in-release server exposed to the internet over HTTPS or something. And then you can have the deployers in another spot actually connecting up to it. So I don't see why that would be.
So these users could be set up within isolated.
Sure. I can see that working out that way. Yep. The only interesting piece is whether the deployer is going to have access to the build drop folder. That would get tricky. So I'm going to say there would be some challenges in getting that working. So, good question. Yep?
I just did a Google, and as of the 11th of July, you can't connect to the TFS service.
Okay.
Release,
thank you.
And they're going to work on it in the future.
That's funny. I probably wrote that, too. I just didn't remember it. thank you. Any other questions before we keep going? Yes, okay. The gentleman over here just mentioned that as of July 11th, it does not work with the service right now, but it's something that we're looking forward to. I would imagine that's the case. We would want parity across. And then the other question, let me remember. Could this be set up for me to be able to release to my end clients that may not be in the same organization? Is that right? Yeah. So. All right, cool. You'll also see that Brian's a member of a couple groups. These can be groups that you set up inside here or groups that are in TFS as well. And so I'll show you a couple of the groups, which is also where you'll set up the security as well. So if I open up the QA team, you can see the different people that are in there. And then security. There's a couple of security privileges that you do have. Can create release template, release path, manage environment, manage server, manage inventory, and then a little bit later you'll see are going through the custom tools and actions. All right, cool. The other thing you may want to do before you get started is update what kind of stages people have. So you see there's just pick lists here. Out of the box, you'll have dev, prod, QA, staging. But if you have a different set of names, you can certainly put them in there as well, and we'll take that. There's another one here called technology type. So I'll show you where that's at later. Yep. Oh, great question. In this particular case, if you you will set up release templates. And so those two sounded like two different templates to me. So you could model it whichever way you want to. And then you create a release using that release template. So you could have an ad hoc break fix kind of release and have it use the direct all the way to production. Or maybe you just go through pre-prod or something. Yep, you could do that. And that brings me to another piece. So if we actually think about what servers are involved here, I'm going to go over here to servers. All the servers that you have available to you will have the deployment agent installed on. And you can do all sorts of different things in here. So for example, you can see what environments it's, this server is a part of. Normally, it's just one. But in my case, I only have one machine here. So part of all of them. You can see what tools are available on that server. So it will recognize what tools are available there. This is where that technology types is. There was one other section here. I'm trying to remember. Oh, yeah, that's right. So as we move over to environments, you can start to see these are groups of those servers. So you can actually go in here and one thing I'll show you in here is the stage type security. So if you have a particular environment that needs to be kind of protected, like production, you can go in here and say, hey, this environment is only available for production, and here's the security around that. So we do have that notion that you can only have, you can kind of separate different kinds of environments. And sometimes people have very controlled QA environments or integration environments as well. So we do have that concept inside here. All right. OK, so let's go take a look at the release pass. There we go, release pass. So a release path is essentially, let me zoom out here. And then I'll zoom right in here. OK. Let's see. Move. There we go. All right. So release path is essentially you tell us what stages are inside of your release. This is kind of a release template. And you can see you've got multiple stages in here. In each stage, you can have four different kinds of activities that are involved with it. There's the acceptance. So hey, I'm moving into the stage. Do you need someone to approve it to even get into that stage? This is particularly interesting. You want production to be on that one. Sometimes QA environments, you want a QA manager to be able to be the approval of someone accepting a new build into that environment, because they may want to have some traffic cop ability to do that. We also have the ability to say, hey, I actually want to also have a separate deployment step. So you let me decide when I want a deployment or when I can schedule a deployment. I'll show you that a little bit later. Validation, this is, hey, that we did validate that. And then you'll see down there, there's approvals as well. So you can set as one or more approvals that are needed for that stage to be finished. And those can be automated as well. Those can be automated. So if you don't need all of these, you just tick the little automated box, and we will keep moving forward for you automatically. You might not want to do that for production. But certainly, if you're in a continuous delivery world, you could do that. Yes? Yeah, so validate is just saying, hey, there was a step. Normally, these are different people that are involved with that. But validate is someone who's actually gone in and maybe tested in the environment and said, hey, yeah, this is good. Approve is, hey, we've approved all of the activities for this stage are done. Validation is just testing. But you may need to also have, you know, design document. I mean, there's a lots of different acceptance criteria that people have. So the approval is there as well to make sure that people have gotten all the things necessary before it moves on. That's a good question. Any other questions? All right, cool. All right, so take particular attention to this one, because we're going to be using this one today. You'll notice that we have everything's automated from dev to QA until we get to production. And production will end up needing our approvals for that. All right, cool. And you can also do security, by the way. So you can have different groups be able to actually edit this this release template, this release path. All right, cool. All right. Now, this is where we go. The release templates are how we actually go about automating the deployment itself. And you'll notice we know about each of these. So you see dev, QA, prod here. But first, I'm going to open up the properties here. This is where we define where the build is. So you'll see you can actually trigger this release to kick off every time a certain build happens. And so in this case, what we've done is we're going to use this release path, which is dev QA prod. And here is the build definition we're going to use. We're going to use the dev nightly build for that. And then we can say, hey, go ahead and trigger from that. Now, you can also do manual ones. That's where the security comes in place. So you can have someone actually start up a release, and you can do that manually as well. All right, so once we have that, you'll see the dev QA prod over here. Let me collapse this so you can see it all. All right, so this is where you start. This is, in our particular case, we only have one server, which is my server that I'm running here. But if we were to come over here on the side, actually, let's see if I can. Is there a zooming? Yes, perfect. All right, over here on the side, you can see all the servers that we would know about are actually in there. So we would just drag that over if we wanted to. So I could do another set of activities on there as well, but I'm not going to do that. Ooh, nope. Delete. There we go. You can put in things like parallel. So if we had two servers, we could put that in there and have them both. Oops. There we go. And you can add multiple servers, and then that would actually have them do different activities. So there's what you're probably not seeing is that this is actually Windows Workflow Foundation in the background. So if you're familiar with the Windows Workflow concept, it's very, very similar. You have all sorts of different capabilities in here. So I'm going to open this up. So on this server, what we're going to do is the first step, we're going to remove the website. And so this is an activity that's ready to go for here. And you'll say which site in IIS that is. Then we'll go in. We have a copy, file, or folder activity, which is available as well. And you'll see we've got two configuration variables here. For here's the source folder. Here's the backup folder. So essentially, we're going to back up the existing site. And then you'll see this call center site. So call center site is actually a component. Remember the component that we saw a little bit earlier? And components are actually under, we actually define what those are. So I am not going to save my changes there. So here is a component. You'll want to define all the pieces of this. And in this case, this is a self-contained website, but you might have a set of services. You might have a set You know, a database is a component. There's all sorts of different pieces of this, and you can set them up individually. And if you'll notice here, you can do all sorts of things. You could say, hey, this is coming from the build, and that build, inside the build drop folder, it's actually located here in published websites, fabricandfiber.web. So we'll always, this first part will replace that for you, but we can do that. You can also say, hey, it builds independently. So this actually comes from a different build definition. And again, you'd tell us where that is in the drop folder. Also, if you're not using TFS build, you can just have any arbitrary UNC path and have the version that you want to be used as a component in there, and then we'll do that. So that's good for any like static tools or things if you're using other build servers. So what you'll see also is you can actually choose which tool is used to deploy that particular component. In this case, it's just Xcopy deployer. We've got a lot of activities that I'll show you a little bit later. And then it has different arguments, and we'll pass those in. And if this one is installation path, that's actually a variable that we are exposing out on the workflow activity that we just had, and we put where that was. And you can see all the parameters that are involved with this particular tool. So we've got lots of tools available. I'll show you all those in a second, and how to register your own custom tools as well. You've got configuration variables, and then you can also see which release templates actually use that particular component. So if I head back over here, I'm going to not say that.
Sorry, another question.
Yeah, sure.
With the configuration variables, does that mean we can have app-setting values that are for production that only limits the number of people who can configure?
Exactly. Yep, absolutely. And so that's what we're meant to do up here. So in essence, you can have all of the deployment mechanisms in here, and we will track those the differences in the configuration variables as well. So that's something that we go ahead and do as well. And we have security around that too. Yep. Yep, so I think the question was, does that mean I can still capture XML configurations, you know, config file settings and those kinds of things? And absolutely, we've got an activity for doing that as well, you know, modifying that. The other thing we can do, interestingly, let me pop open. We have this concept, I'm going to remember 36, if I remember right. Man, 36? Nope, went too far. We have this ability for tokenizing your web config or your configuration files. So what you'll see in here is you can have a regular web config in there, but if you'll put a web.config.token in the same build folder, then what we'll do is on deployment, we will actually use that one. And we will replace the values that are inside of there with the values that you can pass in at the release time. So you'll see, in this particular case, we've put a token of SMTP host server. And you can certainly define those a little bit later, too. So those are another way that you can handle that particular scenario. And so that way, you just keep both of those in version control. When you're doing, you know, local development, regular development, you can be using the regular web config for that. All right. Any other questions? Oh, 1 second. I think someone in the back. Yep. Yep. It works with any XML-based configuration file. Yep. Good question. I think there is a for each. Oh, no, there's not a for each. So what you can do is once you've got this, you can just copy it. You can copy it. And then take the same exact steps and copy it multiple times. And in this case, it would just be in a different server. So.
It's not like
no, it doesn't look like you can. Certainly something we need to look at, though. So you think about a web farm. Yeah, so a little bit later, I'll show you how to actually create custom tools. And then you could use those. So you could make a chocolatey tool if you wanted to. Yep, that's actually a really good idea. If you're not familiar with chocolatey, it uses the NuGet kind of a paradigm for being able to install regular software, essentially. So it takes from NuGet feeds and just helps you install it. It's a crazy easy way of getting things going, too. User voice. Visualstudio.uservoice.com. These would be great suggestions for them. You can actually vote on other ideas. And we actually take a look at user voice from time to time and use that for our product planning. So please get those in there. All right, cool. Where were we? All right, so let me go ahead and I'm going to collapse that again. We'll show you where we're at. So then we've got the call center site there. You can see the installation path is actually the parameter that actually comes from the tool. So we put that in there, and we'll just say, hey, put it in the dev folder, since this is the dev stage. And then we have other abilities, like, for example, create website is an IIS activity that we can do. And you can tell it, hey, this is going to actually create the website in IIS, and what app pool do we want to use, and that kind of thing. So once you've done that, you can also even put in rollback steps. So if you take a look here, these are the rollback steps that if something did go wrong in the previous steps, it can go ahead and do this. Now, we don't have a magic rollback button that knows how to roll back your application. Only you will know how to do that. But we have several different tools available for you to, you know, deploy a new DAC pack, or in this case, this is a simple website, so you can roll it back by taking the backup version and move it back. So any question about rollback? It's an interesting one. How many people actually do rollback? Yeah? How many people do roll forward? We actually prefer the roll forward approach. So we don't spend a whole lot of time thinking about rollback. We actually just push out a new fix and do that quickly. So it's an interesting area right now around rollback. All right, cool. All right. So you can take a look. The other stages are exactly the same. You can modify them if you want them to be slightly different. Essentially, that will help you out quite a bit. All right. Now, what I wanted to do is, in inventory, I'm going to show you the tools. So these are the tools that are available. You'll see there's all sorts of different ones, IIS, MSI. These are the actual base tools. And what that does is it actually tells you, hey, you know, IIS deployer. Well, this is actually a special executable that we have for you. And here's the arguments for it. Here is the resources for it, and we will actually go deploy that to those servers whenever it needs that. So that's one thing we can do. Oh, let me close that one. There's a couple of other ones. You know, there's just a command line runner that will let you run any arbitrary command line, but it actually uses PowerShell to do that. So you can do PowerShell scripts. That's a lot of this is we've done with PowerShell scripts. And you can see which PowerShell scripts we've actually done. You're free to modify these however you'd like. You can create your own. But once you've established the tools that are available and what the arguments are for those, Then you can come over here to actions. And actions are using the tools. So for example, with the IIS tool, you can do things like create site, delete site, update site. And then this is where you actually go in and say, hey, this is what I need to do. Create website does this. It passes in these parameters to that tool. Here's the parameters that I ultimately need to pass on to the person who's modeling the deployment. So you can add any number of tools, even your custom tools. You can add any number of actions. And these actions end up showing up in the workflow designer for you to be able to then move over and pop it into your deployment. So it's a really easy way of doing that. And it kind of helps you capture that for you. And we even handle the deployment of those tools for you as well. All right, cool. All right, now let's go over to Visual Studio, and I'll show you how this works with the build process. So I'll kick open build over here. All right. It needs to wake up. There we go. All right, I'm going to show you a few things. I've got this build that we have available. There we go, like this one. So this is that build that we saw earlier that ended up building. It's got the normal build information that you're used to, you know, number of tests, the change sets that were involved, any work items that happened to be bugs that were fixed, other things. You can also go down and see all the information in here, including the release part of this. And I'll show this to you a little bit later. But we've actually gone in and captured that as part of it. So if I come in here and edit the build definition, and I go down to process, you'll see, there we go. The build process template is a little bit different. It is the in-release default template. And so what this does is it actually has some additional pieces on there that will allow us to configure this specifically to use in-release and trigger releases that were going on in the release server. And really, the only thing you need to do is set release build equal true. And that will let the in-release server know, hey, I've got a new build available for you. You should think about moving it forward in a release process. Another thing you could do is, if you wanted to, you can limit it to what stages it's allowed to go to. So you might not want it to go to production every time. So you can do that within here, too. But typically, you could just leave it, it as release build true and then leave it empty. So it's really easy to get that going. This is just a regular build. And at the end of the build, if all the tests succeed and everything, then we'll pass it off to the end release server. So very typical TFS automated build. There's nothing really special about it. We do have activities in there. So if you have custom build processes, you can take a look at what we've done in the end release default template. And you can take that and customize it however you need to, or take the pieces, just the pieces that we have in there as well. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to change this over to continuous integration. We have lots of different options here. This is just regular TFS build, including scheduling it, you know, a nightly build, or you can say rolling builds. But I'm going to do continuous integration. So I'm going to have it set up to get me close to continuous delivery. So I'll save that. And then I'll close this out. Now I'm going to open up a solution straight from version control. And I'm going to start and make a change in here. So at the moment, I'm going to show you kind of what our call center site looks like. So we've got, this is kind of what it looks like. What I want to do is I'm going to release a new version. And I want to make sure that it goes to each phase. But this is what we have in dev. I have the other sites here, QA and production as well. So we can take a look at those. Now this is the solution. And I'm going to go in here and I'm going to make a small change. So I'm going to go into the views, shared, and then the layout. And what we'll do is, where is it? you know, I could do is use that cool browser link thing, but I have the preview install, not the release candidate. Where is it? Let's see. Support. There it is, the H2. So I'm going to zoom in. All I'm going to do is I'm going to just say, hey, this is V2.0, just so you can see it. So we'll get that checked in. Updating for new release. There we go. So I'm going to check that in. And then what should happen is we've got the continuous integration build already set up. It'll notify, it'll detect that change. It'll start building it. We'll see that start to build in just a second. So we'll take a look over here. Take a look at here. You can see my build. My build is starting to go here. And we'll start to see that go over time. This is a great time for a question if anyone has anything.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that supposed to be, you know, a solution for updating your database with each new build, or is it kind of just...
That's a great question. All right, so there's actually, the question was, hey, I saw there was a tool that was called Execute SQL script. Is that a solution for being able to update my database schema from release to release? You can certainly go that route, but there was another tool in there called the DAC pack. If you're not familiar with DAC pack, that is the artifact that's created with SQL Server data tools, where you can store your database schema inside of version control, inside of TFS. And then in the build process, once it builds, let's say, your website, you can also have it compile your database schema as well. And so it'll put it all together into this DAC pack file. And so it's at that version of time, you know, build 1, 2, 3, you've got a DAC pack with that, that set in there. So it's got all the stored procedures, everything. And then what you can do is that DAC pack, use the DAC pack tool that we have available, and we will, one of the arguments is, hey, where's the target server? And what we'll do is we'll actually generate a change script on the fly, depending on where that, that database is, what schema version it's at. So if you haven't seen that set of tooling, it's already available to you today. It's a great way of changing how you do ALM. The database guys are going to be this, you know, they're still associating with work items, they're doing all that. The build process is actually kind of cool because it goes in and actually, you know, as we compile regular applications, we get to find warnings and errors. Does the same exact thing with the database compiling. It'll go and figure out, hey, you know, you're talking about this table there's a row in that table in the stored procedure, and it's not even there. We'll find that, and it will break the build. It'll fail the build process. So we'll think about referential integrity and things like that. There's lots of other tools like refactor, rename. There's a bunch of things that you can do in there. But SQL Server data tools is a really good way. I would actually go that way, because that way you will always have the version of schema at that point in time in the drop folder, just like you would have any DLL or executable. It's a really cool thing. And if you're scared about, which you should be, if you've never seen it work, if you're scared about what chain script it does put together, there's an executable that you can use with the DAC pack. You can just say generate the SQL script instead of actually pushing the changes. And then you can review to see what exactly it did. So you can take a look at that, review it as much as you want to, and then you can feel good about the change script code that it does put together. Yeah, the SQL team owns that. It's a great way of introducing database schema change management in your ALM process. Go the DAC pack route. All right, cool. So we just finished up here. We can see that we've got the release part right down here. If I were to go over here and take a look at this, let's refresh this. Oh, I might have talked too long. We would normally see that there is there's two here. Oh wait, it might just take a minute. Normally, it would say there's two here. There's two. That means there's one more in the traffic queue for the dev environment. But if I were to open that up, please help me. All right, did I just do that? Yep, 9.4. All right, cool. Oh, it already deployed. OK. Normally, we could see it going on, but we were talking. So you can see all the activity that's happened here. And if I were to look at the details here, you can see all the individual pieces that have happened. So you see, hey, all of, you know, here's the accept. But we'll notice that Brian actually needs to approve it as it's already done. So you see, there you go. It's appending. What I'll need to do is actually need to go be Brian for just a second. No one can be Brian, right? All right, and if you go into my approval requests for Brian, you'll notice he has an approval here. And he can look at all sorts of information about that. So I'll open that up. There we go. He can see, hey, that build trigger has been done. He can look at the workflow sequence. It's not an editable copy. He'll see the read-only bits of that. You can go in and do that. Here we go. And then if he wants to, he can actually approve this. So he'll go in, approve, make any comments. Yep, this looks good. And we'll say OK. All right, cool. So you'll see it starts to go on to the next step. We've moved up to QA. And you can see, hey, there's a deploy here. It is going in and removing the website. If I were to go and take a look right now, you can see, hey, the dev environment should have support v2. We'll hope that it did. There it goes. Let's see what's happening in the QA environment, see if it's made it there yet. Ah, yeah, it's removing the website. There we go. Let's watch it. See where we are here. Oh, it's in progress. Good. So we can see this going forward. It's the same exact deployment. We've tested it out. If there were any problems, then you can come in here and see the step details. I can even open up the deployment and show, hey, there's logs as well. Let's see. Let me go in here. Let's see here. This deployment, where's the deploy? There's the deploy. Here we go. You're looking good here. Any of the logs that are available from the tools, we can actually store those as well. So if you have any problems, you can take a look at what's in the PowerShell, all that. All right. All right, so now we should have some additional, here's one, the QA team now. We have to approve that release, so I'll go ahead and do that. Well, let's just make sure that it's actually working, right? There we go. OK, it's good. So I'll go in, approve that one. And here's the logs. You can actually take a look. And we could go in and see what's going on. But I'll go ahead and approve that. Ready to go to production. All right, now, so once we've done that, it can be done either. So if we had the SMTP server set up, it would actually send an email out. And that approver, it'll have a URL in it instead of in there. So we could actually see that within the web client as well. Yes, sure.
How does rejection work?
Yep.
Can it roll back, or can we set it up for it to roll back?
Yeah, so it depends where you go. So. In this particular case, we're about to, you know, there was a couple of automated approvals in there. We're really only approving the final part of the stage. But in this next step, before it actually deploys, we could actually reject it, and the release would stop there. No, it doesn't. That's a good suggestion. Yep. But it would show it on the release view. You could see where things are. So if I were to open up, just got to remember where that one, I think it's 1,000, if I'm not mistaken. Yep. Got to love ports, all in the same box. VSALM 1000 IR. So if I were to see, right now we can see it's in prod, but we're waiting for acceptance here. So I can see all of that inside there as well. All right, cool. So if I take a look here, it is ready for accepting the deployment to prod. I just wanted to show you as well, right here, you can actually reassign this. So if you don't want to be the one that's approving this, you can be reassigning it to someone else or another group. So that's an option for you as well. You can certainly do several of those. I'm going to say, for this one, this is the step that's before the deployment. So we've had Brian actually do that. So we'll say, yes, we're ready for prod. Now, the interesting thing that's different with this one is that you can schedule it, or you can say you're ready for it right now. So you can go ahead and give your acceptance and then have it happen, you know, tonight or a certain time. So we haven't seen this one before because they've been automated approvals. But now that we're at the point before the deployment, we can actually see and schedule that at a certain time. And so when that happens, we'll have that go. So I'll go ahead and just say, hey, go to prod now. So we'll let that go. If I were to take a look in here, we can start to see that the deploy is in progress now for production. So we'll let that go for just a second.
Is there a way to handle environments where you don't have access to prod?
Yep, so we envision dev and ops to be able to work together. And ops set this up in a way that you can deploy to your production servers. And I mentioned a little bit earlier that you can set up security on specific environments. You can set it up to where, hey, you know, a dev or a QA person can't actually approve it to go there. You know, even no matter what release template they end up setting up, this environment is only, you know, you have to have approval from someone in ops or someone. So yeah, you could do that. We've designed it that way. We're in a DevOps world, so we want to get our IT brethren and dev folks to work together. Yep. Was there another question? I'm sorry? No. You can set up multiple.
But the deployment itself, I mean, the one that runs the script in the database and the one that deployed into the same account? Or would be
no, it's whatever account you set up for the deployment agent. So the deployment agent is the one actually running it on the box. And the deployment agent talks back to the in release server using a service account. But the run as account is actually done on the server itself because it's a deployment agent. It's a good question. Yep, so whatever you set it up. So in production, you know, the production guys are going to go to the production server, set up the deployment agent, put in, you know, have it run as, you know, a certain service account that only has access to production. But it's up to them to do that. Yep. Yep. Anything.
And does it also support non-Windows environments?
It doesn't support non-Windows environments yet. Yep, it's just a Windows space, but we can handle any technology that you want to. Yep. Nope, so you would just register those tools in there. It's certainly something we should probably put on the backlog, but you could register the published tools for Oracle and rollback. Yep, and then you can add them and put them in your sequence. Yep, good question. Any other questions? Yep, sure. Yep, so I don't have anything set up just yet. Do we have a session on that? I think we actually have a session on that. Do we have a session on MTM and automated tests? Yeah, Anthony Borton's doing a load testing talk. I'm surprised we don't have one this year. But oh, we just had it? Oh, how about that? So yes, so we have the ability in Team Foundation Server to store test plans and test cases and model those test plans with test suites. And those test cases they start out as manual, and then you associate automation with each of the manual test cases, and that's what makes them automated. And then what you do is you say, hey, I want to run these test suites in these configurations on these environments. And then that kicks it off. Now, we actually have a tool for kicking off an MTM automated run, and that's available in here. Let me go ahead and go here, and there we go. MTM automated test runner. And for us, it's just a PowerShell script, but it calls the TFS APIs for queuing up a new test run, and we tell it which environment it should go do that. So then it just goes, runs, reports back the data back to TFS.
So you could call into any automation suite and have it return back to
yep. And if there was a problem with it, it would fail. So then it would go do the rollback, if you had a rollback. Yeah, so it's great. So you start to see all of the pieces start to flow together. Now, we wouldn't be able to wait on like manual testing. And that's really why we have those extra steps, the validate step. Whoever does the validate step just needs to make sure, hey, you know, automated tests were acceptable. You know, manual test, exploratory testing runs, all of those have been done. So that's why we actually have that, you know, human step in there. Those are good questions. Yes? Oh, well, that'd take forever, right? No. So this does the deployment, and once the deployment is done, then those other activities happen. And so you're still in that stage; you just haven't gone past the validation step of that stage. And so everyone else would say, "Hey, we're in this stage, but we're waiting on QA to actually validate it." Will this handle SSI scenario support? I'm actually not familiar. What's SSI?
SSI.
Oh, SSIS. Sure. Can you do it by command line? You can do anything. We got PowerShell. We got all sorts of stuff. If you've got a tool to deploy it, you can do it. If you need to install something, msiexec.exe. Give it the installer, /i. We have all sorts of different things that you would be able to do with that. You know, heaven forbid, if you need to make your own executable, you know, for doing deployments, you can do that as well. So that's an option for you as well. All right. So now that we go over to, let's take a look here. I'm going to go in here, go track releases. If we take a look at the releases, you'll see that we have our release there. Oh, I think Brian needs to actually go approve one more thing. Yep, we'll do that. This looks good in production, and I think we're good to go. All right, so we can go take a look at this. We now see that it is released. We can see that it's in the prod stage. We can go back and look at any of the pieces that happened inside that release. And we're good to go. Everything's in TFS. We have all the necessary information that we need for that. And then you're ready for the next release. Yep.
Is any release kind of designed to be integrated with TFS?
So it's built on TFS. Right now, it's a standalone tool. So you could create components that take builds from some UNC path. Doesn't matter how you got it there. Eventually, this will, you could probably tell it'll be part of TFS, though. Yep. That's a good question. All right. Any other questions? Yep.
Besides integrating it with the other Microsoft tools, what other plans do you have to take the product forward?
That we're still figuring out. Our first goal is to Microsoftize it and get it as part of the packaged product, get it in place, and then we've got lots of plans. So if you think about the kinds of things that we've done in the past, when you have access to lots of different kinds of data and the traceability across those, we're able to do really, really innovative and meaningful things to be able to help you out with that. So you'll start to see releases be a very first-class citizen inside of TFS and take advantage of that in lots of different ways. So we are going through that planning process right now, actually. Good question. Yes, sir. It is not public knowledge how much we paid for it. We are a publicly traded company. Let's see. The in-release team has three people on it. It used to be owned by InCycle Software or InCycle Consulting. They survived as an entity, so they still continue to do consulting. I think over 2 or 3 years. This is 2-3 years effort for 2 or 3 devs. And they all joined us, so they just moved up to Seattle. Acquihire. I'm sorry? Acquihire, yes. That's great. All right, well, cool. If you do end up having any questions, I'll be in the dev den. Feel free to let me know. If you have any questions, the other thing I'll do is I'll just put my... See if I can't find that slide. Where's the slide? I'll put up my contact information again. But thank you, everyone. Let me know if you do have any questions, and try it out. Thanks.